How to empower your neurodivergent employee resource group is the focus of our day. And I am joined this morning or this afternoon or this evening or wherever you are with three of my most esteemed colleagues. You have on your screen the lovely Irina Marenica. Would you like to have a little wave, Irina? Hello, the lovely Irina Marenica, who we have worked with since 2014. Herself a rather international psychologist and a business and organisational psychologist. We also have the lovely Angelica Simpson. Little wave from you, Angelica. Genius Within's head of HR. We have the lovely Royston Collins. Genius Within's commercial director. I love how everyone's got their own little dance this morning. That's about right. Yeah. So we are going to, who's doing our slides? Steph, are you doing our slides? Woohoo! Steph is also online. You can't see her. She's behind the scenes, Steph, with the slides. So we're going to go through. Do you want to just go on to the next one? Thank you. We've got Irina. So Irina is going to talk to us about the context and purpose of employee resource groups and how to make sure that they have agency. And agency is a kind of word that means power or influence or the ability to act. So Irina, do you want to just say hi? And anyone got any burning questions about Irina?
Hello, does anyone have any burning questions about me? Thank you, Nancy. I probably want to start by talking about context, purpose, and agency. But do we want to do an introduction for other colleagues, or do we want to jump into?
I was just deciding that. I was going to see where you went before I made up my mind. You're going to go straight into yours, which is lovely, and you should. So just to let people know, after Irina's spoken, Royston's going to talk about the hows. So Royston is our commercial director. He's also an absolutely stonking operational manager who's been kind of running businesses and offices for many, many years. And Royston is very good at going, well, how does that work? What do you actually have to do? So Royston's going to talk you through some of that. And then the lovely Angelica is going to talk you through boundaries, remits, confidentiality, and then the emotional labour and well-being part. And we've put this together based on our experiences of supporting ERGs, neurodivergent ERGs across the world, actually, on our experience from internal Genius Within, because Genius Within is kind of like one massive ERG, because 60% of us are disabled and or neurodivergent. And we're also quite a diverse team in many ways. So that's where we're going, and I think now I will hand over to you, Irina, and I will shush for a minute. In terms of questions, we will probably do all the questions at the end, and we'll go from Irina to Royston to Angelica, but if I kind of see any in the chat that I think are only relevant to Irina, Royston or Angelica and not to the whole group, I will sort of put some out of them. So is that all right if we don't really have a plan? I quite like it when we don't really have a plan and we just go where the interest is. I know lots of people really like it if you have a plan, and then if you don't stick to it, they get very grumpy. So I've just started going, I'm not going to have a plan, and we'll see where it goes, because then people don't get grumpy. Anyway, overthinking it, over to you, Irina.
Thank you, Nancy. Definitely up for not having or having enough of a plan to go through. Everyone is different, and it's important to just be okay with that. But in Genius Within, when we are looking at the context, the purpose and the agency, we might be working in an organization who is creating a neurodiverse employee resource group, or we might be providing consultancy and services in an organization who is already supporting, in a way we are supporting an existing employee resource network. But it is important to, regardless of that particular focus, it's important to focus on the and consider the context in which the ERG is already operating or is or will be operating, what is the purpose that we're looking at, and as Nancy said, what constitutes the agency, the power, the ability to communicate and have a dialogue and an exchange in the organization when it comes to the context and the purposes. But let's jump into and look at what the context tends to involve. And when we start at the top, as it were, and first of all, we will appraise the broader mission of the organization, whether the organization already has a wider neurodiversity inclusion strategy or not. What is the aim, what are the aims of the organization, what are their values, and those values again will be looked at either in the context of the neurodiversity wider neurodiversity inclusion initiative or more broadly as well. Also, we will appraise short-term, long-term goals of the organization and have a look at the current business practices and some of the related objectives. We will seek to understand what is already working well, perhaps in the context of different ERGs or just more broadly. And of course, what are some of the challenges that exist in the current system, in the current processes. And this can be within the sort of the context of the ERG, or again, more broadly, when we look at neurodiversity inclusion initiative and strategy in the whole organization. And I think if you are thinking about this, there's nothing stopping you from appraising and thinking about the organization's wider mission, values, goals, the business practices that are already in place and objectives that are there, things that are already working well, either in the neurodiverse ERG or more broadly within another existing ERG more generally. So you can always consider all of those nuances to formulate that inception of context. And I think when we think about context and to emphasize the importance of contextualizing the role of the ERG and enabling the voice of the neurodiverse ERG, let's have a look back and see how the ERGs have actually become part of the modern organization. And when we talk about the ERGs, it's not a new concept. It's been there really since 1960s, not necessarily in the context of neurodiversity, that is relatively new, but we saw the then called affinity groups, for instance, that were created in response to the racial conflicts that were present in the society. And I think in the 1960s, this is when we began to see that dynamic where individuals need to be socially connected, and that need coincided with the business goals of improving diversity, improving kind of inclusion within the workforces. But I suppose it's fair to say that the relation between the ERG and the organization has evolved since then. And in their Global Human Capital Trends report that was released in 2020, Deloitte talks about the rise of the social enterprise. Now, when exploring the nature of the social enterprise, it states that the simple acknowledgement of corporate social responsibility doesn't cut it anymore. It's no longer enough. And I suppose given the changes that we've seen both in the workplace and in the society more broadly within the last decade, the social enterprise is something that now means bringing a fundamental change in how the organization balances its own needs, its own business needs, within the needs of a broader ecosystem. And unsurprisingly, we've been seeing a number of the organizations in the IT and the financial sectors that have been recruiting and sourcing neurodiverse talents and neurodiverse potential for specific roles already. So that is a practice that already exists and aims to balance aspires rather to balance the needs of the organization and the needs of the individuals. It is, however, early days, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Can I have a next slide, please? Thank you. So let's bring that back to contextualizing an ERG as part of a wider neurodiversity inclusion strategy. And looking at that, we would recommend considering some of the long-term goals that the neurodiverse ERGs can support and the goals that are in line with the ethos of the organization. And here are some examples. It was really difficult to narrow it down just to four, but I give it my best shot. There can be very many. For example, in the UK, we have a disability confident employer scheme. There are equivalents in various countries, and an organization can consider becoming a disability confident leader, which is the highest tier of the scheme. And this is the badge that you kind of get that represents that. And in the highest tier, the company not only is drawing from the wide pool of talent, hires, develops the neurodiverse, potentially and other health needs and disabilities as well. But the organization as a leader already is acknowledged for sharing their inclusive practices, their inclusive strategies with other organizations or with the wider community. Some of the other things that you might consider as long-term goals is pioneering a neurodiversity recruitment and inclusion program, or supporting research into best practices, whether that comes to supporting the ERGs or whether that's a broader neurodiversity inclusion narrative and other aspects of neurodiversity inclusion. And of course, gaining a wider recognition as a neurodiversity or neurodivergence employer of choice. Next slide, please.
Can I just interrupt, Irina? So before we go on, just wanted to add into that. So the Disability Confident Leader Program is a UK specific thing, but there are lots of things all over the world like that. And there are increasingly international disability organizations like the Valuable 500, like Disability In the USA. The International Labour Organization has a global business disability network, which you can contact to find organizations in your area that would be able to. So that, and those are called business affinity groups. And so there's a kind of affinity group within the company, but there's also business affinity groups. And that's one way to tap into that wider knowledge and recognition.
Absolutely. And one of indeed many. Thank you, Nancy. I hope that that's useful for everyone as well who's tuning in the UK and overseas. Now, let's jump into talking about the purpose. So once we have explored the context and the mission of the business, we would invite you to continue working with the ERG to explore specific purpose and design objectives that the neurodivergent ERG can achieve, again, as part of the wider neurodiversity inclusion strategy and the set long-term objectives. And if we want to jump to the next slide, here are again just some of the examples in which and the neurodiverse ERG can contribute to achieving inclusion in the organization. Talked about the disability confident approaches, but also supporting change management, looking into increasing visibility, but also providing feedback and serving as a sort of focus group and informed support for a variety of areas in the organization. It can be something to do with the HR in terms of reviewing policy and providing feedback on policy, as well as recruiting, developing and retaining neurodiverse talent, providing social and professional support for members, for example, some kind of mentoring programs or any events that provide visibility, or any actions as well that provide visibility within senior leaders as well, function as a part of advocacy to help promote learning about the causes of the ERG and also the positive change, such as increasing neurodiversity awareness and visibility in the workplace and improving work practices in that range of, in that cloud of areas that you see on the screen. And let's hop into talking about agency, because context and purpose have been established, but what we can look at and what can be another important point from the onset when empowering a neurodiverse ERG is indeed agency. And when it comes to the ERGs, although they can originate at the corporate level, in most cases it is something that the employees put forward as their own initiative. And the risk here is that this can relate to a lot of bottom-up communication pathways. And we would suggest mediating this by involving and creating a dialogue from the onset with senior leadership. So here you can consider things like securing senior leadership engagement and sponsorship, really thinking about the communication pathways and how you facilitate that dialogue, that exchange. What does that look like when the ERGs communicate with senior leadership? And also together with the ERG, you can design a process that really allows that evidence-based communication, talking about the goals that you've set, the values, the missions, the objectives, but also tangible actions. What would you see happen first, and what is the sort of sequence of SMART goals that you're going to follow to achieve those longer term objectives and involve the ERG. So that is all from me for the moment. Are there any questions at all, Nancy, that are in the Q&A that relate to either context, purpose or agency?
At the moment, there are actually. So someone has asked, should neurodiversity have its own ERG or should it be lumped in with another? So I'm going to let you have a little answer of that, Irina, and then I've got something I'd like to chip in on that as well.
No worries. It's something that paradoxically, I suppose, the organisation and the ERG should decide individually, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And it's very much about those purposes that have been discussed in that context. Also, I think another point there is a lot of the times we get asked whether neurodiversity should be together with the disability, with the wider disability ERG or any other health needs. And again, you have to think about the resources, you have to think about sponsorship, but you also need to remember that not all neurodiverse individuals identify as being disabled, and that's a cornerstone to their identity. So how you arrange that and how you decide on whether it's a part of another ERG or a separate ERG should very much be part of that context, purpose and agency.
Yeah, so I mean it does overlap, doesn't it, with disability quite a lot, and I think there's a potential kind of there's a potential grating around how much is neurodivergence a disability and how much is it not, and what if we think it isn't, is that because we're saying something pejorative about disability, or you know, what is the kind of identity of those different groups? And so yeah, it depends what you're trying to achieve, doesn't it? So the thing that I wanted to say on that is that one of the things we've just decided to do at Genius Within is start an ERG that is a diversity coalition, because we're a small company. We've got 53 employees and 200 associates. So, and we're a majority neurodivergent company. So it doesn't make sense to have a neurodiversity ERG. We kind of are a neurodiversity ERG. But what it does make sense to do is to bring people that are minoritized or marginalized in our kind of existing communities together to sort of review their experience and ensure that there's a focus and And so we've actually created an, we're actually creating an intersectional ERG, which is a completely different idea. And we will see how it goes and see, see what it, you know, what happens. But yeah, but it depends very much on the purpose, exactly as you say. Annabella has wants to know where the neurodiversity advocacy lead ideally sits structurally. Is it a function within HR? Is it independent? You know, the head and coordinator of local ERGs, for example, in Europe, Middle East, Africa. Sort of, you know, is it about location? Is it about function?
Again, it's a brilliant question that I don't want to throw it back at the person who's asking the question, but it is something the organization has to decide. And that depends very much on the size of the organization, whether you are in multiple countries, and how does that leadership structure and leadership communication then work? Because do you have a D&I lead who is specifically sort of designated with communicating with both the leadership and the ERG representatives and chairs, and then do you then facilitate and spread out the communication sort of horizontally when it comes to the ERGs in different countries or the different ERGs representatives? Again, when you have a joint strategy that is concerned with neurodiversity inclusion in the whole company, you can operate within that framework and see what are the goals, the objectives, the needs of the business that that framework dictates effectively.
I think this is it. And I think to summarize what you're saying, Irina, which I think is absolutely the right point, you really, before you set this sort of stuff up, you've got to really think about, what are you doing it for? What is its purpose? Is its purpose around a sense of belonging and community for people who come to work having been in existing marginalized positions? Is it just for that? You know, is it for the camaraderie? In which case, geographical locations make the most sense, or functional, you know, but, or is it because you want the ERG to create some sort of activism within the organization and create change? Or is it both, you know, and how do you best sit that? So in answer to your question, I think really, Annabella, is there's no right answer to that. And it's got to be really sympathetic to what's already happening in the business. And you might get it wrong to start with, and you might need to reform and redirect things. And I think there's a life cycle to this stuff as well. So when we're looking at our diversity ERG, our intersectional diversity ERG, we're thinking about term limits for members. And, you know, people come on board and they do sort of 6 months or 9 months or a year, you know, come in with a specific purpose. And then we switch the membership, because otherwise it can get stayed. So that's a bit of a risk. And then David's chipped in that in his last role, neurodivergence was part of a disability ERG, but neurodivergence had a sort of subgroup within the disability group. And I think that's a really useful way of doing it as well. It's quite nice to be part of the disability ERG, because what those two groups have in common is the need for accommodations and adjustments. So if you're, that's a very practical knowledge-based thing that all disabling conditions, be they hidden disabilities, physical or sensory, you know, they have those things in common. So they do in some ways sit apart from other forms of D&I. Irina, do you want to come back in on that one?
Let me chip in on that very quickly. Mm-hmm. This is a very important point as well in terms of prioritizing those goals and objectives. And the question is, and I will, it's not a psychology presentation if it doesn't have a Maslow hierarchy of needs equivalent. Are you starting with the top of the pyramid and the self-actualization and the shinies, or are you starting with the sort of bare necessities where you look into those health and being provisions and include sort of improve the visibility, improve access, inform your line managers about, you know, how they work and what are the referral pathways, and then kind of structure it upwards from there in terms of other inclusion perspectives and visibility and HR policies, and then move on to the recruitment programs, which actually makes it a lot easier because you already have the provision in place to facilitate those recruitment programs, and your line managers are already trained in it. So
yeah. And James has come in as well and said that for him there's three aspects: HR, business and employees, and that the ERG is very much employees, but the goal is to bring the three together and it can't be HR led. So I think there's a difference between being HR led and in HR engaged. I mean, one of the things that I've seen as problematic in supporting other ERGs and other companies is when the ERG sets itself up in opposition to HR, when the ERG feels that its job is to fundamentally change HR because HR isn't working for its group, whatever its group might be, but neurodivergence, and then you get into a bit of a combat. So I think, you know, being HR led is different to having HR buy-in from the start. Where I've seen companies really make massive changes quickly is when HR are totally bought in and totally see and feel the strategic value of being more inclusive of a group, and also acknowledge that that means that there's going to be quite a lot of work for them to change in what they're doing. So it's difficult. It's a difficult one, but where HR and ERGs set themselves up as opposing forces, HRs tend to win. HRs tend to win, and ERGs tend to feel even more marginalized and minoritized than they did before, which is which is unfortunate. So I think HR, how do you get HR buy-in? Well, that's a very large question, Elena. And I've got some experience of how we've done that at Genius Within, which we can share with you, but I don't think there's an absolute tick list. You absolutely have to do this, but I can talk to you about it, definitely. Lovely. So a disability charter that HR bought into, that's wonderful.
Ledgers as well. And I think an important point to make is also that very generic question, but actually quite an indicative question as well: whose responsibility is it? And when parts of the organization can confidently answer everyone's responsibility, then they know and they will have an underpinning and understanding of their role, their contribution, their initiative. And again, drilling it down to a more concrete connection to goals, to values, to the mission for each specific part of the organization, whether that's the ERG, the HR, the leadership, is important.
Absolutely. And it is about that agency. You know, where is the power coming from in the ERG? So if it's not connected into HR, who's giving it its oomph and its ability to influence in the organization? Does it have a different leader? Does it have a senior sponsor? Does it have a budget? Does it have who's there that can actually take things that come out of the ERG and make it happen? And that does naturally fit with HR. So if it can be an HR senior sponsor and an HR influence, I think that that's a very valid, but it also needs to have cash, doesn't it? If it doesn't have cash or the ability to influence cash, then it's not necessarily going to make the dent that you want it to make. So I think this leads us quite neatly on to Royston, who's going to come and do some how stuff. So Royston, are you there, Royston?
Hello.
You are there. And can I just say as well, before Royston comes on, I'm really sorry, our closed captioning didn't start at the beginning of this webinar. So we have now got it right working. If you're a person that likes closed captioning, please do start using it. And if anybody needs it for the first bit of the program and you're watching this on recording, let us know, because we can retrofit captions to the recording. Okay, so I apologize again. And Royston, over to you, and keep coming with your chats, and I'll keep bringing out. I know there's one about the Business Disability Forum that we missed in that chat, but we'll have a few minutes. We'll have about 20 minutes at the end, so we'll be able to go back to that. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thanks, Nancy. Steph, if you could move on the slides. So I'm going to talk about creation, design and measurement are my three areas. So I'm talking about the practicalities of setting up an ERG. So the nitty gritty, really getting into some detail, some things that we know that would work, and thinking about how you can move it forward and who do you get to do the buy-in with you. So Steph, if you could move on to the next slide. So how do you create your neurodiverse ERG or your neurodivergent ERG? There are kind of four stages to doing this. So the first stage is about identifying your startup group. So who is your startup group? Who are the people that should be involved? So thinking about who you are working with in your businesses now, there are likely to be informal groups or collaborations already. So it shouldn't be too difficult to identify people. So some people would like to volunteer. Some people would consider applying for a job. Different sectors, different businesses do different elements to this. And we see it really successfully running when it's, you know, advertised as a specific job. So things to consider, looking out for your DEI champions or other ERGs that may be broader, such as disability themed. Tap into your HR or wellbeing networks. These are really, really useful resources. Have you noticed there have been specific requests from staff or from employees, colleagues? Reach out to your colleagues that may have expressed an interest. Gauge that interest. One thing that's really popular that you can do is to advertise proposals in some company communications or newsletters to really promote the fact that you're taking this seriously. And things to think about is it exclusive? Are you making it exclusively for neurodivergent individuals? Are you bringing it in as part of a wider disability forum or a disability group? What are people's personal interests? You may well have colleagues that are interested in being part of the ERG because they have family members that are neurodivergent or close to the subject. What specific conditions are you looking at? Are you considering the overlapping conditions? Are we looking at complex mental health, physical disability, the cognitive deficits that are caused by some conditions? Could they sit in this ERG, in the neurodivergent ERG? Do you have sufficient representation? It's really, really important to have a good representative group. It can become quite a sort of sounding board of just one person's views or individual opinions if there's not enough representation in the group. So the best ERGs we know welcome employees from all backgrounds. They cultivate cross-cultural relationships, and that happens both within and outside the organization. The most effective ERG programs encourage cross-collaboration between and among affinity groups. So we spoke about affinity groups earlier. They take advantage of the synergies, they encourage the transfer of knowledge, and they fuel business objectives. So the second part is looking at a champion or an executive sponsor, or even both. So champions are really, really important in ERG worlds. Can you identify an employee champion? Ideally, you really want somebody that's in the leadership team or management or HR, somebody that can really push forward your neurodivergent ERG agenda. You know, can you really champion it? Can you promote it? Do you have the backing? And then alongside that, you need to consider the resources for that backing. It doesn't just happen. I've seen some comments in the chat where we talk about people volunteering their time. You know, that volunteering is admirable. But actually, let's think about, you know, your ERG being a functional part of the business. You're looking at a budget, you're looking at the time, and you're looking at a place. The champion can take the lead to help develop and shape the group. And the executive sponsor is the person that can define expectations for the roles. So some of those typical responsibilities might include serving as public advocates for the group, influencing other company leaders, lending support to the group's goals, mentoring of the ERG members. And effective executive sponsors exercise their influence. So it's a catalyst for growth and is a connection to sustained funding. It's business relevance and there's an impact. And with those resources, when you're looking at budget, time and place, are you giving the staff that are attending or the employees that are attending the time to do it? Do they have a budget? So let's look at those logistics before we arrange a kickoff meeting. So Steph, if you could flick to the next screen, please. So around design, this is the part where you need to think about the true logistics of your group. So define your leadership, agree your roles and responsibilities within the ERG. So your chair, your administrator, talking about those roles and responsibilities, who is doing what and how long should they do it for? Do people come in and just join periodically? Do you have people that are in permanent posts? Are people on short-term contracts to support your ERG? I think some of the things that you need to think about in this area is the emotional value that people will bring into these roles and these elements, but there's also considerable emotional drain. And Angelica will touch on that in her section. What are the membership requirements and expectations? So do people need to consider that they attend regularly? Do they need to have some formal guidance around their expectations? Part of this has already been mentioned is looking up and maybe perhaps drawing up a charter for your group or some best practice. Looking at those guidelines and structure, bearing in mind the mission and purpose that Irina spoke about, taking into account those goals and objectives and looking for those success factors and how you're going to measure that. Agree your budget management and agree the frequency of meetings. You know, don't make it sporadic, make it a regular thing if you can. It's a really, really useful tool. I would say that ERGs are beneficial to an organization and the health and well-being of their employees. It needs to be considered as a vital work function and not an after-hours activity or a social, which sometimes it can be seen like that. Bearing in mind your members may request funds, resources or approvals, so links to management are really key. The ERG might need to consider things like marketing or meeting spaces, professional support, coaching and mentoring. It's important to remember ERG members are employees that are already underrepresented minorities, so they may not be comfortable making requests. They might need that active leader to take that forward. Being transparent is important, considering a broader view of the roles and responsibilities. So can roles be shared? Do you need a rotating chair, perhaps? Who takes the minutes? Do you have an administrator or just a rotating note taker? And who is responsible for following up the actions? Who's taking the lead? Futuring, going forward, you're looking at things like events or sponsored events. Events are a really great way to promote your ERG. Think about your main purpose of your group and what is in scope or out of scope for your ERG. And lastly, in your design, thinking about what metrics will you use to measure your ERG's performance or their impact. Steph, if you could move on to the next slide, thank you. So meet, share, measure. So you've agreed your purpose, you've got your scope and your principles of the ERG, now it's your time for action. So what's next? So considering your accessibility and inclusivity of your meetings, make sure you're working to the same goals and objectives, and who are you sharing your findings or your outputs with? That's a really key element there. Thinking about your metrics, thinking about your triage and support pathways and moving forward, looking at your engagement events and promotion. So consider some of the best practices for inclusivity. So do you have a pre-agreed agenda for your ERG meetings? How long are your meetings? Do you provide enough breaks in those meetings? If it's face-to-face, have you got a suitable environment? Do you have breakout spaces or decompression space? Does everybody get the opportunity to speak? If you're doing it online, can you allow cameras on or off? Do you agree some basic etiquette? Some really important rules that are, you know, such as raising hands in meetings can be really useful. The underlying principle of your ERG is inclusion and bringing employees together. So it's important to remember that in your format of your meetings. So who are your stakeholders? Who are you sharing your information with? So it could be your HR, it could be your talent acquisition, it could be senior management, it could be board or training and development, well-being teams, the wider employee group. There are so many stakeholders that are likely to have interest in your ERG and what can come out of the ERG. What changes or developments or improvements are you really hoping to affect? How do you measure your success? You know, what are your success factors? So just to give you an idea of a few, there are some key metrics that you can track, that you can report on some trends, such as member involvement, group membership and event attendance, participation in the ERG program, such as mentoring and community service, and budget performance. And the effectiveness of ERGs can be tracked with several different means. So looking at recruiting event representation, retention rates and employee engagement or satisfaction are really useful. The other thing to consider as we move on to the HR piece is thinking about the support structures that may be required for employees within the group. So agree some boundaries, provide opportunities to signpost towards the relevant support services, such as coaching, mentoring, counseling, health and wellbeing services and your EAPs. So consider your wider engagement events. So every year we see companies do lots of really great work championing neurodivergent individuals or teams. We have Neurodiversity Weeks, we see Pride Weeks. These events are really, really key. But what's important is that we see that happen throughout the year and not just on these weak events. And ERG members are often the subject matter experts. So likely they're the best placed people to be involved in any of the planning for any of the events. So it's really important to ask them, talk to them about their resources and their contacts. Thank you very much. Has anybody got any questions on those practicalities?
Oh my goodness, there's so much going on in the chat right now. You have no idea. I mean, honestly, what's interesting is what's going on. I mean, lots of feedback about how useful that is. And David's pointed out that metrics should always go back to purpose and what matters to the employee. Absolutely. So if we think about what Irina was saying around, you know, what is the context in which you're trying to do this? You know, how are you going to create agency and what's your overarching purpose? Then when you get down to the nuts and bolts and you start thinking, right, how are we, I mean, what Royston's been discussing is kind of just really super good practice for operational management, which is why he's so good at it, because that's been his thing. But it kind of forces your hand. So as you're creating those metrics, you're going to go, oh, have we really defined our purpose? Mm. When you go into those details of trying to organize it, what you realize is maybe you need to go back a step and go back and go, actually, what are we doing this for? What do we expect to change in the business? Is this about retention? Is this about hiring? Is this about well-being? Is this about engagement? Is this a strategic move? Is this about how we want to be more representative of the customer base we serve? You know, there's just so much, there's so many options for what your purpose might be. But when you come to think about those metrics, it will really sharpen your attention. So there are a few kind of questions, and there's a theme coming out about the kind of how ERGs can somehow end up doing kind of the work, and being an ERG isn't the same as doing the work. So I wonder, Angelica, if you're ready, I wonder if we should just move on to your section, because that speaks to those issues more directly. Mm. And then we'll come back for questions at the end. Are you ready for us, Angelica, my love?
Yes, indeed.
Hurrah.
Hi everyone, so Irina and Royston have done a great job so far, so I'm now going to discuss with you the processes and potential issues that you should consider to protect both the employees and the business. I'll be covering confidentiality, boundaries and remits, and emotional labour and wellbeing. When looking at confidentiality, we'll be exploring how we empower individuals to talk openly about their lived experience, whilst maintaining professional boundaries and confidentiality, and the structures to be put in place to manage disclosures from your members. One of the challenges when setting up your ERG is making employees feel safe. It may be difficult to convince employees of the safety of their personal information, and this might result from a fear of colleagues sharing a member's sensitive information with other colleagues outside of that ERG group. So how do we maintain confidentiality? ERG members should be provided with specific formal guidance, and I know that Royston touched on that as well earlier, to help them with the practical governance and implementation of the ERG. And this guidance should outline how the ERG will communicate, highlighting the terms of confidentiality within the group. It does sound a little bit MI5-ish, but should members sign a non-disclosure agreement, for example? The ERG must operate within the terms set out within the guidance, so there's clarity, coherence and consistency of all of the site of the approach in all ERGs across the business. In regards to confidentiality, it should be made clear that the onus is on the leader and members of the ERG group to raise and escalate any matters to HR, safeguarding leads or senior leaders if there are any concerns about the ERG activities or any aspect of its membership or leadership. It should be clearly outlined to all members that practice not in line with the formal guidance provided will result in intervention from the organisation's HR department, safeguarding leads, or senior leaders. When handling disclosures, clearly define the role and responsibilities of the group leader so that they know the process to follow when a disclosure is made. Ensure the safeguarding policy is provided and read by all members. And all members should be provided with information on the support available to employees in order to signpost them correctly, whether it's to their line manager, HR, an employee assistance program, or safeguarding lead. Boundaries and remits. How is participation in ERG activities governed? It should not be expected or assumed that members of the ERG carry out their role and contribution to the ERG on top of their normal day jobs. It's important to position the ERG as a tangible core value-add activity to the business that's afforded time in its own right in the same way that other business roles and projects are. And it shouldn't be treated as a voluntary contribution carried out in the member's spare time. It needs to be recognised that being a member of the ERG is still contributing to the organisational goals of the business. And in determining time allocation for ERG members, practically consider what the business can accommodate. For example, this could be from around 2 hours to half a day per month, but bear in mind that this may be a little bit higher during the initial setup stages. So make sure you agree this is a formal part of the individual member's role and gain agreement from the department that they work in. And if you've got the sponsorship of the leadership team, as mentioned previously, it should be relatively easy. Formally discuss and communicate the role of an ERG member with line managers so that members aren't required to justify their participation in agreed ERG activities. Ensure that members receive active support in day-to-day so that they can participate fully in the activities. They don't have to do it in their norm outside of their, you know, normal working hours, and they're not pressured or expected to carry out this in their own time. This might require adjusting their current workload to free up that time. What we need to avoid is adding to their current workload, which will result in driving members to burnout. As Royston's mentioned previously, ERG members are underrepresented and they might not feel comfortable bringing up their workload with their managers. So by setting out the expectations, this will provide clarity for all. Now onto the personal boundaries. Remember, it's not the role of ERG members to give advice on diagnosis or workplace need assessments for other ND members. From an organisational perspective, this exposes the business to a risk of disability discrimination. For example, reasonable adjustments have been put in place for one employee, but not the other. If members are discussing their requirements during the meetings and other ERG members are providing advice, the relevant people in the organisation, such as HR and your line managers, lose that visibility and risk not providing appropriate reasonable adjustments, which can have further legal implications. If members need reasonable adjustments, they should be signposted to HR and the line manager. From a confidentiality perspective, reasonable adjustments are private and confidential, and discussing with others, is that appropriate? Should it be kept as private and confidential? And as we know, reasonable adjustments are individual and what not one size fits all. Counselling and providing advice to other ND members may also trigger individual experiences, which creates further emotional labour for the ERG members. So it's really important that members are provided with guidance on the remits of their role and signposting contacts. This brings us on to emotional labour and wellbeing. So topics discussed during ERGs are likely to be triggering to both individuals with lived experiences and allies within the group. So what support can you put in place for all? For any network, the discussion of employees' personal experiences, good or bad, can be an extremely powerful tool in raising awareness of these issues and tackling stigmas. These discussions, however, can at times get quite emotional, resulting in members carrying the emotional burden of others as well as their own. And this needs to be managed carefully if they're not to cause more problems than they actually set out to address. So all conversations held at work, regardless of who they with, must be conducted within a framework of fairness, respect, and dignity. ERG members need to be open to the perspective of others. Contrasting viewpoints can minimise automatic biases. We know unconscious biases exist, and probably within us all, and the aim of the ERG is to create a safe space to discuss these issues, but they don't operate as an excuse to allow members to justify their issues as being out of their control because of these unconscious biases. So this should form a formal part of the guidance that I've mentioned earlier. In the case of George's v. Pobble Group Limited, an employment tribunal upheld a Black employee's harassment claim after she attended some diversity training, at which the trainer wrote racially offensive terms on a flip chart, and staff were encouraged to shout out the most offensive words that they could think of. Whilst it's really important to discuss the group's lived experiences and issues faced, being aware of the possible offence during these discussions is equally important. So providing training on discrimination and the protected characteristics in accordance with the Equality Act 2010 for all ERG members would protect both the members and employer, enabling the organisation to follow normal disciplinary procedures should any discrimination occur. ERG members should receive training on relevant policies together with ongoing training on equality and diversity issues within the workplace, and records maintained showing that members are aware of the policies and have received the relevant training. Finally, when thinking about support for members, this could include decompression sessions after each ERG meeting, ensuring wellbeing is being discussed in one-to-one supervisions and that line managers are regularly checking in, creating a buddy system across ERG groups, but bear in mind maintaining the confidentiality of the information within the groups, signposting to your internal employee assistance programs, mental health first aiders, counseling services, and coaching and mentoring if available. These are like really important things that we need to consider to make sure that employees, members, and the business are all operating in the correct way. Thank you for listening. Over to you, Nancy.
Thank you, Angelica. So we've got some kind of mixed feedback going on in the chat now. Some people are going, oh my God, yes, this is so what's happening. And yeah, we absolutely need to know this. And then there's some other kind of, actually, this is quite daunting. And I think, you know, one of the reasons that we wanted to run this course, to run this workshop today, is because at Genius Within, we are spending quite a bit of time picking up the pieces when ERGs have started and they've not been well resourced and they've not been kind of supported by the wider organisation. Would you agree, Royston, Irina and Angelica, on that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I see us being called in to do some support whereby, you know, quite often it's conflict. So we get confidentiality has been broken, discussions have broken down. Sometimes that can be really challenging. So this, you know, the whole confidentiality piece is really, really important.
And I think, you know, no matter where you are in the world, most data protection confidentiality laws treat diagnosis as medical grade data. And so anytime you're discussing another employee's situation, you are sharing medical grade data. And when things go very, very wrong and they end up in litigation, that's very often where the angle can be. So there's also some people that are really kind of finding this, you know, they're actually listening to it and going, actually, yeah, we're doing that and we've got this connection, and it's quite affirming to some of the things that they're doing, which is great. But we've got some good questions, so I'm going to start asking them. So someone wanted to know, what are typical metrics? So what are the things you would expect to improve or change if you were running if your ERG was embedded in your organization, running well and supported well? What would we expect to get better?
So I can talk about a few of the metrics as mentioned earlier. So this all leads back to your ERG purpose and your mission. But quite a lot what we see is some of the metrics are around recruitment and retention of diverse individuals within a company. And that's a really good thing to be able to measure. Easily, you know, easy to track. It links in with HR very, very closely, or your talent acquisition. And then tracking that through. So, you know, your ERG can be the working to champion the cause. You link in with your HR, and that may well be the ERG working with certain policies or procedures within HR that are simply exclusive or making things very difficult to get a more diverse population within the business. So, yeah, that's a really useful one to track.
Irina?
I'll pop in and talk about perhaps a metric that is less what I view as less useful to track, which is disclosures, for example. And that doesn't necessarily apply to the ERG specifically, but that is something that's a bit of a buzzword that we hear from the organization as well, and wanting to have and present with perhaps the best of the intentions to show how diverse the organization is, again, given the volatile world that benefits from that varied discourse and varied opinions and views that often come from neurodiverse thinking. But the reason the metric in terms of disclosure doesn't work very well, it again comes back to the legal focuses as well as other ethical approaches where you're focusing on the impact as opposed to a label, and it's good practice to in well-being provisions in the workplace and more broadly to explore individual experiences and think about the kind of adjustments that perhaps are recommended through the health and well-being services. But then at the same time, the more useful metric, if not disclosure, then what is representation? So perhaps if you do have a well-established health and well-being provision, including, as Angelica brilliantly pointed out, a range of the services that can be present, the occupational health referrals to engineers within will provide a range of individual services, including workplace needs assessments, individual coaching, group coaching awareness sessions based on the kind of individual needs, etc., line manager training or co-coaching, if indeed there is a disagreement, I would say, or there is a need to kind of get on the same page when it comes to management and individuals. So when that health and well-being provision is well established, you can record representation, and you will do that actually really quite quickly, as opposed to, you know, rolling out a yearly survey to ask people to disclose their medically sensitive data. That creates a lot of ethical nuances. But if you are looking at the representation, for example, with the individuals who have engaged with those well-advertised provision services, you are doing a lot of good for the ERG, but also for the wider organization in terms of supporting and enabling and retaining that neurodiverse talent. So that is a point to consider. Sorry, long-winded response, very passionate about the disclosure, not metric. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Irina. Yeah. So essentially the kinds of things we expect to change are around how free and open people feel to share in the organization, and therefore those levels of authenticity and bringing your whole self to work are going to affect things like engagement and turnover and absenteeism and stress absence. But I think the other thing to remember is they also affect performance and productivity. You know, those are harder to measure and they're less tangible. But when people are relaxed and confident and working well in a team, then the team generally performs better. So you would expect to there to be some sort of uplift in company output and team output, depending on how wide your group is and how large your organization is. Royston or Angelica, in fact, do you want to come in on that at all? Is there anything you would expect to change from a HR perspective? But you know what? So we're doing it at the moment. So we're setting up an ERG at the moment, which is a more intersectional ERG. But what are you expecting to get out of that as we go forward? What do you want to see happen?
I think we're quite lucky in Genius Within, because even when I started working at Genius Within, I noticed how diverse it was. And that was quite important to me because I've never seen that diversity before. So opening up that arena and just having that recognition, so when somebody comes in and they can see themselves represented, is so important. So it's looking at your culture as well, which is obviously bigger than an ERG. So I'd say it needs senior leadership teams to be filtering down and looking at what are we doing in returns to recruitment and hiring, and making sure that we're opening up the room, we're opening up the floor by having those diverse employees there. Because I know that in the chat, somebody just said, well, how do we encourage disclosures if people don't want to say that they've got the neurodivergent or, you know, so I think the ERGs, like starting it and then making senior leaders listen as well, like talking up and saying, this is what we need, this is what we want to see, that then starts ringing alarm bells in senior leaders to make sure that, okay, we need to listen, we need to put these things in place.
And then we've got, I mean, we've got loads of really good questions coming on. It to change the culture. Claire, what you've just said there, I think is what people fail to understand about all D&I, but particularly in our expertise, neurodiversity. It's not a tick list. It's not a toolkit. This is a culture change. If you're going to do neuro inclusion, you're changing your culture as a business. And so therefore it's not a little thing. So, you know, as an ERG, to change the culture to feel safe for a wider range of people. Exactly that, Marcia. It's very, you know, it's quite ethereal and it feels quite intangible. And that isn't because you haven't worked out how to do it. It's because it's quite ethereal and quite intangible. So, you know, one of the questions that we've got is around, you know, as the neurodivergent ERG, we're currently doing most of the work. There is, of course, a massive burden on doing that. You are listening to people's stories. You are being shared, you know, confidential thing. Yes, that's good for allyship, Sam, and that when that information is shared as a choice, that creates allyship. But do you as the ERG then feel resourced to handle that confidential information? Do you know how to use that for allyship as opposed to sharing it widely? Do you feel supported in that? So, Angelica, putting yourself in the, you know, when you used to be in HR for another company that we won't talk about, but other companies that you've worked with where you were in a more kind of standard and traditional HR role, what are the kind of things you would have needed to hear from an ERG that you think would have won resources from HR? What are the winning themes for getting HR on side?
I think just being honest and saying, like, I can't be my true self. I need to, like, people come to work and they hide who they are because they don't feel safe enough to be themselves. So talking to your HR departments and just saying, like, I know that people are too scared to talk up. People can't tell you what they need because they haven't got that employee voice. So even if you're starting before ERGs with employee engagement and making sure that you're having regular surveys and listening to what the people need. If you're giving them the opportunity to tell you what they need, then you can listen. But if there's no opportunity for that employee voice, then you're never going to understand or know what's required. So you've got to open up the employee voice of your organisation as well.
And do you think most HR teams are willing to listen to that?
Depends on the metrics that they're measuring, isn't it? From past experience, if it fits their metrics and it fits the trend of the season, for example, then they'll listen.
I just have to add to that. I have to say, being able to come to work as your beautiful self, your comfortable self, really, really pushes forward your own personal health and well-being. You know, not having to mask and act differently or be differently, and be genuine is a huge, huge sort of bonus. It really does help and it really ups productivity.
And I think I'm busy typing because actually Paul has just come up with something which I think is a really good example of everything we're talking about, which is, you know, can the organization assign tasks? I can't find it now. Yeah, can the organization see the ERG as a tool, expectations or assignment of work, like reviewing policies, participating on selection panels as an example? And that's where I think your remit and your boundaries question comes in, because yes, to a certain degree, but, you know, at what point does the ERG start actually doing the job of HR for it? And is that an appropriate thing? And how much time have you given them? So if you're running every single policy through an ERG who are were working in their lunchtime or meeting in their lunchtime or doing that at home, you know, where is their boundary? And I think there's someone else in the chat who said that they think that their ERG manages boundaries really well. And I think, you know, that's perfect. When that happens, it's brilliant. But also to remember this is a vulnerable group. We are a vulnerable group. We neurodivergents are a vulnerable group. We are very often legally disabled. And so employers have a responsibility to our well-being. And then when you add in intersections of race, ethnicity, gender, socioeconomic background, you start to find that actually not everybody is assertive as you might hope them to be. And so if people keep asking, you know, so in some, there are some of us for whom saying no has been, you know, culturally drained out of us because of our gender, because of our age, because of lots of things. And so for those of us who aren't very good at saying no, the ERG can just start being something that we feel really passionate about. And it can end up being something that absolutely drains us and heads us into burnout. So that's why the biggest feature of this workshop today is advocating for you guys to have structures and boundaries and safety roads and go, right, who's in charge? Where's the money coming from? Where's the resources coming from? What's the boundaries? How much time are we expected to put in this? And if it starts to go over that time, what do we do about it? Who do we talk to? Because what we know is that as a community, neurodivergence, we're not terribly good at managing our own boundaries, actually. We're not very good at it at all. Apart from those of us with pathological demand avoidance, we're great at it. But unless you've got a couple of those in your group, you know, you might find that you're kind of acting out of remit. You're being asked to fix things that you really don't have the expertise to fix. And so if you set this up well, or if you've already set it up and you go, oh no, we haven't set this up well, you can still change it, get those things in place, and that will prevent you from having burnout. There's good evidence that people that work in diversity and inclusion have higher rates of burnout than the general population. And if you're in an ARG, you are working in diversity and inclusion. That is what you are doing by being part of that ERG. And it can be triggering. You're supporting colleagues who are experiencing, you know, discrimination or exclusion that you have yourself experienced. And that's an emotionally vulnerable place to be in. So I was working with an ERG recently who said that since they started the ERG, their inbox is absolutely full of people around the company messaging them to ask for help. And so, you know, at what point does that become so overwhelming that you can't cope? And an employer does have a responsibility to you and that person at that point. And so there's a support group for ERGs. That's just said Sam. I think that's a wonderful idea. There should be an ERG support group for ERGs. The chat's gone through too quickly now for me to keep up with it. Royston and Irina, you're quite good at keeping up with the chat as well. I'm not sure whether Angelica is or not, because I haven't done this with her enough, really. It's not because I don't think you have, and I'm oversaying it again. But yeah, Royston, Irina, anything else that's coming up for you that you want to...
Just to pose one question that's come in on the Q&A. So what are your thoughts on signposting ND support at the applicant stage or correct content for the diversity company statements? Ooh. One for you, Irina. I knew you'd like that one.
It is one for me. Let me put up the Q&A. I see that. What are the thoughts of signposting ND support at the application stage? What at any stage, really? It's an important point to acknowledge the lived experience and the diversity of the experience that informs the company approaches in terms of policies and provides that feedback in terms of the visibility, in terms of the workplace design, in terms of how we support individuals in the wider organization. But I think there's very much that question in terms of when we have a medical condition, do we turn to a friend who has had the similar experience, or do we go and ask that friend about who they've turned to seek medical treatment and medical support? And that is the fundamental difference between areas where NERG is asked. I mean, we've had this kind of furthering on what Nancy was saying earlier, we have had experience when an ERG representative was asked to provide and comment on the adjustments that need to be provided. Where are they drawing on that experience? Also in terms of workplace design, in terms of it being inclusive for neurodiversity as well as this kind of other disability nuances, there is a risk that perhaps it won't have the same critical consideration. Not so much, you know, I come from a clinical medical field, and it's not about sort of opposing and coming back to the clinical view of things. It's more about when it comes to the expert input, it very much comes to that critical appraisal, critical consideration, that perhaps the ERG representatives just purely may not have the resources to get involved in. I mean, reviewing an office space or redesigning an office space to be inclusive, or redesigning the recruitment process to be inclusive, is a huge task. It is an undertaking normally. Do you want individual or a group of individuals of doing that, or do you want an expert to come in and actually evaluate all of those nuances and missions and values? I think another point to add to what's been discussed previously, a lot of the issues that are being raised very much sounds like, and ERGs are in there, neurodiverse ERGs are in there, that they are relatively new, and by relatively I mean they are more new than other types of ERGs. So there's a lot of sort of establishing that is happening, and I think that's why the things that Royston and Angelica have talked about are absolutely essential at those but at the same time, it all very much sounds like that bottom-up communication issues that I've been talking about. What are we working towards? There's the concept, the freedom from and the freedom to. Yeah. What are we trying to get to at the end of that, and how does that factor in to the work that we're doing on a day-to-day basis?
Yeah, I mean, it's all about boundaries and remits. You know, do you have the, you know, are you boundarying this work? Are you boundarying your own time? Are you contributing something that you feel able to contribute? And is the thing that you're asked to being asked to do within your remit? I mean, I've seen some horror stories. So there was an ERG where they changed. It was mainly autistic people on the ERG, and it was quite a small ERG, and they were a group of individuals who really didn't like company socials, so they were lobbying HR to change the standard policies that autistic people were never invited to social occasions because it might make them feel put on the spot as a matter of neurodiversity inclusion. It's like, well, that's not appropriate for it, all autistics, let alone all neurodivergent people. And there are, you know, so there's have you got the skills to make the advice that you're being asked to make, or that you think is necessary? Or actually, is your job within the ERG to point out where the holes are and ask the company to fill those gaps? So I've seen some, I've been interviewed by ERGs for work that Genius Within has done. You know, they've had ERG members in the procurement process, making sure that the services that the business was bringing in were properly neurodiversity friendly for them, you know, and fitted with their neurodiversity culture in their organization. And that's the kind of thing that's within remit. It's very boundaried, whereas kind of review all the HR policies and tell us where the holes are. And then fix them is a huge job. James has said that his previous training with the Samaritans helps me with his sort of boundaries and roles. And I think that's a really good point, James, because actually it's that training that's allowing you to do that. And a lot of people don't have that training. And so kind of handling vulnerable information, handling people's distress, their mental distress, their experience of discrimination, that is a thing in and of itself. And if you've had training, if you've been involved professionally in that sort of thing, then you will know about things like supervision and where to kind of, you know, how you can park that information and how you can deal with it and when you need to speak to somebody because it's triggering things to you for you. So that's why training like that is a really good idea for ERGs. And someone else has popped in the chat about Purple Space, which is an amazing organization. I can't remember if they're UK only or whether they're International, but Purple Space do have a forum for people that work in ERGs, and Purple Space are disability generalists, but they're incredibly welcoming and neurodivergent inclusive within their disability sphere. So I would really recommend joining Purple Space, actually. They are a good organisation. We like Purple Space. Okay, I wonder where else we've got to. Was there anything else I've missed? And ditto, someone asked absolutely ages ago about the Business Disability Forum. Again, very good organisation. We're members of the Business Disability Forum and lots of those other affinity groups. But those things, you only get out as much of them as you put in. You know, they will be an absolute resource of toolkits, tick lists, trainings, awareness, networking events, mutual support for ERGs. You know, all of that will happen. But do you have the time to go out and get it? Do you have the money as well? Because their membership fees can be quite steep in some of those organisations. So yeah, can you kind of go out and get, do you have the time to go out and benefit from that? Because otherwise it's just one of those things that's like another load of stuff coming in your inbox with things you probably should read and look at. And so, you know, do by all means join those things if you can invest in them. There's definitely some awesome people running those organizations. We know lots of them well. Okay, what else is coming through?
Go on.
No, you go, Irina.
On the point of external organizations that support ERGs as well, I think even I just want to reflect on the changes that we have seen in the last 7 years or plus in terms of the conversations that are being had. I remember distinctly, and Nancy, we had a chat about this, an HR asking me whether dyslexia is covered by the Equality Act, or in terms of recognized provision is covered by the Equality Act. And these conversations have moved on to a more nuanced discussions and topics. So it's definitely an ever-evolving area, and there are organizations that are doing a fantastic job in terms of wider neurodiversity inclusion, and also the ERGs as well. So, and there's a lot of really positive shared practice, and also in terms of products that are put externally and not just the internal processes as well. So it's definitely a multifaceted area, and the ERGs can be amazing in informing all of those nuances and more. It's very much having that structure, having that baseline, and then seeing what are the essentials at the moment, and what are the essentials longer term, and how do ones feed into the others. This practical bigger picture here, so there we go.
So just cycling back on a few questions that have been missed. How open are companies nowadays towards self-diagnosis? Many neurodivergent people don't want medical paperwork. Agreed. And actually, you shouldn't need medical paperwork. The basis for disability status is not reliant on medical paperwork. It's reliant on an assessment of chronic long-term difficulties in day-to-day activity and then the things that you're being asked to do. So it's a kind of interaction between person and environment that defines whether you've got legal protections as a disabled person. I wrote something for the Society of Occupational Medicine on diagnosis recently, and I'm going to, with my colleague Brenda, I'm going to stick it in the chat as a link for you. And then someone else has asked, any solutions for ERG leads who are feeling burned out? Yeah, I think there's a few of you here, aren't you? We see you. That's why we're doing this. We see you. Your burnout is not unusual. It's a very common thing, and not just for neurodiversity, also for people in gender ERGs, race and ethnicity ERGs, LGBTQ+ ERGs. It is a common thing. Any advice? Royce, we haven't heard from you for a while. Or have we? Is
it any advice?
Sharing.
My advice is take a break. You know, we regularly talk about taking a break to step away have somebody step in for a bit if you can, you know, talk to your HR about the support strategies around burnout. What do they have you can rely on? Can you go to an EAP? You know, reach out externally. Can you get some mentoring support or some coaching support? So think about some of these things that you can really, really do. But yeah, reach out to your HR, see what they suggest. Burnout is, you know, is a well-known problem within ERG circles and certainly within smaller sectors and groups. So yeah, reach out. Don't do it on your own.
What would you do, Angelica, if one of our if our new intersectional diversity ERG leads approaches you with burnout?
So following on from what Royston says, really, and I think the way to avoid that is having terms. So somebody doing it for 3 months, 6 months, not just the same people, because like I say, when you're constantly doing it, we're all working for the same cause. We're passionate about things that we're doing. We want to do it. But then, like you say, there's got to be a stop point. So if you just have terms is what I'd say, just rotate it. So it's not saying that you can't be in it, but just do it for 3 months, see how you get on, and then rotate it around and have other people come in, and then just keep it rotating is what I'd say.
Yeah, and having a co-chair, and yeah, not doing it on your own, absolutely. And then there's a point where actually, you know, forget the ERG, this is about you as an employee. An employee of ours is burned out, how are we going to support that employee? And so, you know, forget what you're doing, you're in the realm of coaching, workplace needs assessment, occupational health, employee assistance program. You know, that's you're burned out by your job, and whether that is your day job, as people unhelpful kind of segregate them sometimes, day job, other thing, it's all your day job actually if you're doing that ERG on behalf of the business. So yeah, for those of you who are feeling burned out, you know, we really see you, we see this need a lot at the moment, which is why we're doing today. And yeah, the mentor rotation is a great idea as well. So we're coming to the end, and yeah, we've kind of still got a few minutes, but I feel like we've made most of our points. And I just want to, if anyone's got anything that I've missed, that in terms of bringing forward questions, now is your time to shine. Or if you've got something I have asked, but don't feel has been answered properly. Julia says it's really good to see companies having more conversations about ND and trying to learn to develop. It's a long way to go, but it's a start. I agree. And I think, you know, one of the things that I don't think we've made this point enough, actually, and I think this point is super important. And it's not necessarily about being one ERG for diversity, which is what we're doing in Genius Within as a small business, but it's about learn from other ERGs. So I've recently finished a systematic review of race, gender, ethnicity, age, disability, and LGBTQ inclusion, where I've looked at the academic literature of those different disciplinary fields and gone, what works in those spaces? So there's some things, for example, that are absolutely big no-nos for in most organizations. We know in organizations that you can't ask the only woman on the board to mentor all the other women in the organization. It's not fair. It's too much pressure to put on that person. And we also know it doesn't work, because if she's the only woman on the board, she probably doesn't have a lot of leverage. And so in terms of her mentoring you, she actually can't open the door for you, because she doesn't have enough agency and power on the board by herself to open doors for other women. So not only is it not fair on that woman, it actually doesn't work. Mentoring in those contexts doesn't work. And so we also are very well aware that the ERGs on their own, if they're not aligned to organizational strategy, if they don't have senior sponsorship, if they don't have some sort of way of contributing and measuring to organizational performance, if they're not linked into organizational practice, they won't work. They don't work for other forms of D&I. Why on earth would they work for neurodiversity? So you can lean into those other ERGs and go, what do you guys find that works? What's worked for you? How have you done this? And I think we're really bad at this in the neurodiversity space. We keep thinking it's all new and it's all us. And it really isn't. Like, there's been inclusion movements for donkey's years, and those inclusion movements have learned a lot, and we need to lean on what they've learned. For example, awareness training doesn't change behavior. It changes awareness. it doesn't necessarily change behavior. You know, toolkits don't change managers. The things that change managers are being held accountable for the goals of inclusion. So toolkits aren't necessarily going to move the dial. Awareness training isn't going to move the dial. And yet, what are we doing in neurodiversity? Toolkits and awareness training. Ah, it's like we've learned nothing for the last 40 years of other inclusion movements. So it's not that that they don't do nothing, but they, you know, they're not going to make the change. We've got to push this on to a more strategic and embedded level, which is what the ERG can help do if it is a diagonal slice representative of the whole organization at different hierarchies across different organized different and across different silos. Joan wants to know what is the average time allocated for ERG members per week, per month. I think Angelica, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think we're looking at 2 hours a month for our team. Is that right?
Yeah.
Hour for the 1 hour for a meeting and 1 hour for prep work and admin behind the scene. But I think that's probably quite a personal decision. And we're also saying we're going to pay them extra for that. Is that right? Yeah.
But they're not all, but I know, especially from the chat, not all employees do that. But that's what we're deciding to do.
And I think, you know, I also know people who have a day a week. They've been the ERG lead and they have a day a week for that within their thing. Irina is either stretching her hands or she has something to say. I can't tell which.
You know, we've had a question in the Q&A from Peter asking about representation as an alternative to disclosure. And I think the reason it's a lot more powerful is that you can measure representation as a metric in terms of engagement with different initiatives such as the wellbeing, health and wellbeing provision, which you then invest into advertising and, you know, making those paths really clear and available, and then recording the perhaps representation of individuals who have used that, and you measure the successes of that as well, which is an all-around much better and a lot more informed metric that involves longer-term business practices in comparison to just knowing how many dyslexics you've got in the organization.
Yeah. So disclosure is just a very simple, what percentage of our company is neurodivergent, as opposed to representation, which is what percentage or what volume, you know, who in our organization is engaging with neurodiversity activities. Okay, we are now out of time. And so thank you very much for all your questions. The chat is always the best bit. Not that your presentations were bad. My goodness, I'm just second guessing myself every 5 seconds today.
The chat is the best bit.
I love the chat. It's really nice to hear from people as well. Thank you very much for sharing. And thank you to Irina, Royston and Angelica for really framing where those questions went and providing such practical information. I've seen so many comments saying this was really useful and this is just what I needed. So yeah, do get in touch if you want to have the slides or the recording, and we will make sure that that is captioned up properly, and go well, enjoy the rest of your Friday.
Or you all leave. So yeah, if you've registered, we'll share the slides, the video and any links that we've put in the chat for you. Thank you.
100%.
Thank you, everybody. Take care.